this paper is titled Mechanism of Nonlinear Behavior Catalytic Reactions on Metal Surfaces, Surface Explosion, Reaction Waves and Oscillation Rates and Selectivity. And the paper is by Dr. Yuan.
Thank you for the introduction, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to start by going back to the 60s. Wolfgang Sachse was professor at Leiden University and introduced heterogeneous catalysis at Leiden, but also surface science, catalysis related surface science. And I would like to show two examples. One of the approaches that he used was to evaporate the metal film on the substrate. By the way, in the 60s, there was no way to analyze the surface. Chemical analysis of surfaces simply was not possible at the time. So, in order to prepare clean surfaces, Wolfgang evaporated the film on the substrate, and another technique that was used was the field electron and field ion microscope. The field ion microscope was the only technique that was able to image metal surfaces with atomical solution. And by using the probe hole technique, it was possible already in the 60s to do measurements on single crystal surfaces. So I would like to show some results obtained by means of Berg function measurements on films using photoemission, and some results obtained with the field ion microscope. Just as an introduction, it was concluded that when you have film consisting of two different metals, alloy, that there is surface segregation. That surface composition is different from that of the bulk composition. It also changes with the chemical composition of the atmosphere. It was concluded that you can distinguish the component atoms on the surface. For example, CO can distinguish platinum from gold. At that time, it was a very noble conclusion. It was believed that you have a common and rigid D-band and that the component atoms, for example, platinum and gold, are identical. It was also concluded that the surface atoms are quite mobile, actually already at room temperature. The same conclusion was also found for nitrogen and CO on tungsten surfaces by means of the field ion microscope. Very large surface reconstructions were found. Corrosion, surface corrosion. So surfaces, it was also a very novel conclusion at the time, surfaces are not rigid, but quite mobile already at room temperature in the presence of CO, nitrogen, or a reaction mixture. We have two presentations from Leiden today. Peter Wouda will talk about alloy surfaces, so our talks are a little bit related to the topics that were introduced by Wolfgang in the 60s. Peter Wouda will show that you can image the position of platinum and rhodium atoms on the surface of a platinum rhodium alloy by using scanning tunneling microscopy. I will talk about work done by my PhD students Nico Janssen and Paul Copton, oscillations of platinum rhodium surfaces for the nitric oxide hydrogen reactions, and I discussed yesterday with Conrad and I would like to show during a coffee break on the video non-linear behavior of these reactions using the old technique of the field electron microscope and also by means of photoemission. Now, it is the microscope, it is photoelectron emission microscope. So that is the topic of my contribution. So let's start with steady state reaction conditions. Nitric oxide reaction with hydrogen. Very low temperature here, this is just one example, temperature 520 K, and illustrates the activity of platinum at that low temperature is already quite high. It's very active. For rhodium, similar surface structure, the activity is very low. But when you look at the selectivity, then it's very different. Rhodium is extremely selective to dinitrogen. And selectivity of platinum is very poor. Main reaction product is ammonia. The reason, and we have now that information in order to understand the oscillations, the reason is very simple. When you do an analysis of the surface, it turns out that ammonia surfaces has a large amount of nitrogen. And already at that low temperature, so you have combination of two nitrogen atoms, the reaction product is dinitrogen. When you look at the platinum surface, then the concentration of atomic nitrogen is extremely low. So hydrogen can absorb on the surface, it dissociates, and the reaction nitrogen and the reaction product is ammonia. So the specific differences between platinum and rhodium are related to the differences in the metal nitrogen bond. And now oscillations. And I will show the number of oscillations that we found for platinum surfaces, for rhodium surfaces. I shall not go into any detail. Anyhow, we found oscillations for the NO hydrogen reactions under oxidizing conditions, under reducing conditions. Wide range of temperatures, and a very regular oscillation, it's a state oscillation, stable for many hours, and by changing the NO hydrogen ratio, you can change period, structure of the oscillations. This is an example where we have one, 2, 3, 4, 5 maxima, just one period. So very complicated oscillation indeed. It's not only the activity, the rate of the reaction, but it's also the selectivity that oscillates in time. Dynitrogen formation, ammonia formation, and NO formation, so dynitrogen is oscillating in phase. NH3, out of phase, is N2O. And that's interesting. And from rhodium, that's very different. Now let's show a number of examples. Now for rhodium surfaces. We have studied 6 different surfaces of rhodium. And selection of these zinc crystal surfaces was based on work that we did with the field electron microscope, what I will show during the coffee break. Turns out that you need double-bond tenses on the surface to obtain oscillations. We didn't find oscillations on surfaces with one-hour tenses. So, for example, you have oscillations on this surface, 5, 3, 3, the surface is about 1 tenses, 1-hour steps, but you don't find oscillations on 7-1-1, the surface with 1-hour tenses. This is 5, 3, 3. Just here the surface is exposed, to a mixture of endowed hydrogen, temperatures decrease very slowly, and suddenly the reaction rate starts to oscillate. And when you look at selectivity, then it turned out that there is an oscillation of selectivity, but very different from that what we found for platinum selectivity. Dinitrogen, out of phase with water, out of phase with NH3, out of phase with ammonia. On platinum, dinitrogen was oscillating in phase with ammonia, out of phase with N2O. On rhodium, we didn't find any formation of N2O under these experimental conditions. So, and I summarize the characteristics of the oscillating behavior that we found for rhodium surfaces. First of all, you need a large excess of hydrogen to get oscillations, reducing conditions. There is an oscillation selectivity. Nitrogen and NO are oscillating in phase, but out of phase with water and ammonia. And we found oscillations only on surfaces with one-on-one tenses. Well, what's the reason for that? Why do we need one-on-one tenses? The reason is very simple. When you look at TPD, TDS of nitrogen, the surface is exposed to NO, you know the shell shakes. Temperature is heated, the sample is heated, temperature is increased, and there is desorption of dinitrogen. And this here is illustrated that nitrogen desorbs at a much lower temperature from surfaces with 1-1 tenses compared to surfaces with 1-0 tenses. This is the temperature range that you found oscillations. For 1-0-like surfaces, there's still a lot of atomic nitrogen on the surface in this temperature range. The surface is inhibited by atomic nitrogen. The reaction rate is low, no oscillations. Find oscillation on that surface, you must go to much higher temperatures and pressures. So there is a very large effect of the surface structure on the binding energy of nitrogen on rhodium. What is the mechanism of the oscillation? What's the mechanism on platinum? What's the mechanism on rhodium surfaces? Is it the same mechanism for platinum and rhodium? Well, the answer is no. Turns out that for platinum surfaces, molecularly adsorbed nitric oxide is the most important species on the surface to obtain oscillations. This is the formation of dinitrogen. In phase with ammonia, out of phase with N2O, platinum 1O. Here, the formation of N2O is at the maximum. So, the concentration of molecularly adsorbed NO is at the maximum. You need NO on the surface to get the formation of N2O. The whole surface is covered with NO. The reaction rate to dinitrogen is very low, because you need dissociation to get formation of dinitrogen. But NO cannot dissociate because you need vacancies on the surface to dissociate NO. But the temperature, 460 K, is very near the desorption temperature of NO. So statistics learns that sometimes an NO molecule will dissolve, and then another NO molecule can dissociate. And then the reaction starts. Then you have this autocatalytic reaction. Vacancies are formed in an autocatalytic way. So the reaction rate increases and increases. The concentrations of vacancies increase and increases. The reaction rate becomes larger and larger. And then it comes to a maximum. Because, first of all, the rate by now, absorption becomes lower than the rate of reaction, and there's an inhibition effect of oxygen. There is a little bit built up of oxygen here. And oxygen inhibits the dissociation of NO, so the reaction rate decreases. Molecularly adsorbed NO is built up, the oxygen is removed by reaction with hydrogen, and it starts all over again. Chlorine surfaces, well, this mechanism is much more complicated. And what we would like to know is what's present on the surface during the oscillations. It's not very easy to measure that. But what we did was the following. There's a large hysteresis in the formation of nitrogen. Increasing temperature, decreasing temperature. There's a large hysteresis. And this is the temperature range where we have the oscillations. Now we have steady state reaction conditions. So we can measure what's present on the surface. And we used a very nice technique, very fast XPS. You can do these measurements only when you have synchrotron facilities. We did that work in collaboration with Mike Iskinova, and it turned out that you have, during oscillations, a periodic transition between a nitrogen rich and an oxygen rich surface. And I show it here on the overhead. There are two different branches. One branch that is what we found during the hysteresis when we increase the temperature. The dinitrogen formation is high and the concentration of atomic nitrogen is very high. There are no vacancies on the surface. And in the other branch, the concentration of nitrogen is very low. The concentration of oxygen is very high. But there are still some vacancies on the surface. So hydrogen can absorb on the surface, it can dissociate, it reacts with oxygen, the water. It can also react with nitrogen and then reacts with ammonia. So water and ammonia are formed in phase, but out of phase with nitrogen. There's a very large nonlinear interaction between nitrogen and oxygen on the surface. I have a lot of data here that demonstrates the nonlinear interaction between nitrogen and oxygen on the surface. The molecular salt in our doesn't play any role anymore. You only need it to build up nitrogen or to build up oxygen. There's no NO directly adsorbed on the surface. So when I conclude, there are very large differences in the mechanisms of the oscillations when you compare platinum with chromium. NO is the species that you need to get oscillatory behavior on platinum surfaces. For rhodium, it is nitrogen oxygen. And a nonlinear interaction between nitrogen and oxygen. And that concludes my talk. So my suggestion is that if you're interested in seeing on the video that there is also nonlinear behavior on the surfaces, so what I showed up now is oscillations in the reaction rate. But you measure by Bismuth spectrometer. But when you look at surfaces and the field electron microscope, and the photo emission microscope are very nice techniques to image surfaces, and turned out that there's also non-linear behavior on surfaces during the reaction. Thank you very much.
Any questions?
I wondered how the product was
harmonized with surface deconstruction?
Yeah, that's a very relevant question indeed. For rodent surfaces, the answer is no. Rodent surfaces, clean rodent surfaces, don't reconstruct. Plectrum is indeed a surface where you have two stable faces with very different chemical properties, the non-reconstructed and reconstructed surface. Mm-hmm. Well, it's still under discussion. I think that you don't need the surface reconstruction of platinum to catch the condensation, but it's still under discussion. We try to model the oscillations. We did the rhodium, and it turned out that you don't need surface reconstructions. Of course, you have surface reconstructions, but we believe, and we have some evidence for that, a strong indication that you really don't need the reconstructions to catch oscillating behavior, to catch synchronization on the surface.
How is it with the alloys? We know from Peter's work that the surface is a first approximation statistical, with some reference of having volume labels. Do we have oscillations on, let's say, separate on really not ordered alloys?
Yes, very good question indeed. We try to find oscillation of platinum surfaces. Turned out that there are no oscillations, at least not under the experimental conditions that we found oscillation of platinum surfaces. It might be, actually, I think that there will be experimental conditions where there should be oscillation of platinum surfaces, but perhaps it's a very different mechanism. The surface composition is very flexible. So I should expect that under certain experimental conditions there will be transition in the rhodium rich surface, and you have oxygen on the surface, and transition to a platinum rich surface where the oxygen concentration is very low. And that should be a very different mechanism for oscillations. So in principle, the answer is I think that there may be experimental conditions to find oscillation of platinum rich surfaces, but then perhaps it's a very different mechanism. Variations in the transitions between stages with different surface composition.
Yes, another question. I remember when I visited Jochen Block, he said, I hope I quoted it correctly, that if he had two metal surfaces which were not in contact, he could get oscillations on one coupled with the oscillation with the other one, coupled by the gas phase.
That's right.
Is that mechanism understood?
Sure. That is probably the main mechanism of synchronization, where you have pressures, let's say, higher than 10 to the minus 4 millibar or so. The examples that I will show on the video, there we use much lower pressures of the order of 10 to the minus 6, and then it might be that the main mechanism is surface diffusion, but that's still under discussion. Anyhow, it is sure now that gas phase communication is a major mechanism of synchronization for oscillations of catalysts.
I have always, it's difficult to conceptually understand that for macroscopic surfaces, because the essential basis of oscillation is that you have islands, and an island of one then cannot react with the other one, and then finally it decomposes. We have or the catalytic effect, but an island is always a small part of the total, and so once the island then is becoming reactive, then you have the autocatalytic effect. Why is not a different island even on the same macroscopic catalyst having its own oscillation frequency? Why are they coupled?
There is. You can see that, for example, the field electron microscope, very nice way that you have oscillations, but on the surface, very small patches that are oscillating without phase. When there is communication between the local oscillators, for example, like gas phase communication, then it becomes synchronized. So, because there is a change in the gas phase composition,
me finish what you say.
So there are three main mechanisms for oscillation. For real catalysts, it's usually temperature variations. Under higher pressure conditions, also on synchrotron surfaces, it is usually gas phase communication. And under lower pressure conditions, surface diffusion, when you have just one single crystal surface or polycrystalline surface, which of course not a supportive catalyst. Doesn't help.
I apologize that I have to terminate the discussion for this paper, so we allow time for you to show the video during the coffee break. Yeah. This is a coffee break, it's missed in the program. We have 15 minutes for coffee break. Two announcements. One is that whoever like to have a vegetarian dish for dinner, please let us know. We need to map the hotel now. And also, there will be a group picture to be taken right after the morning session. Presumably, you start at 12:15, the car will run a little late, but let's all get together before lunch, right after the session, and take a group picture. Where? You'll be right outside here. So let's have a coffee break and continue this. And for the video,